You gon' listen to what you been missing, man. She hot. Who you got for your radio? Got to be your entrepreneur, make my radio rock. From Atlanta to the Cayman. Internet came in out of East and the West. Both of them, what you saying? And this is how I get my day in. Bitch, like I'm a brand new stage. I'm loving what you play. Out with the old one, and with the new one.
Beat Drops Radio, Beat Drops Radio.
It's the Bianca Burwell Show. Thank you. It's the Bianca Burwell Show. Thank you.
Beat Drops Radio.
You are tuned in to the Bianca Burwell Show on the BeatDrops Radio, your top 45 and R&B station, Newbie of Atlanta. It's not as cold as a summer month like it was yesterday, but it's close. So apparently the weather is supposed to get a little bit better before week's end. And I am looking forward to that because good gracious, it's just been absolutely ridiculous. I saw ice passage on my way to the bookstore earlier today, just ice patches. So y'all be careful. And also up in the north where they're experiencing feet of snow. I'm sorry for y'all. I absolutely hate. That's the reason why I came down south. The call in number is 404-826-9223. Again, 404-826-9223. What's going on to all my UK people? Y'all are tuned in hard today. What's going on, y'all? Appreciate you for listening. Today, I have a special in-studio guest. His name is Vincent Levy Bryant. Again, Vincent Levy Bryant will be in the building today. He's got a fantabulous story, and he actually appeared on one of my other shows on the station, and I really wanted to have him on because I just felt really inspired just sitting here listening and talking to him, and I'm pretty sure you will too. He's an entrepreneur, composer, musician, songwriter, sound designer, filmmaker. He just got all kinds of things happening. If you want to see everything that's happening as it happens, just go to TheBeatDropsRadio.com, click on Watch Live, and the Q&A box is open. If you haven't done it already, like us on our Facebook page by going to the website, clicking on the F. It'll take you directly there. Once you're there, just go ahead and suggest that to everybody that you know. Follow us on Twitter. Well, I guess you can. Can you follow on Twitter? I don't know. Anyway, follow on Twitter at BeatDropsRadio. And also my Instagram is Bianca_Burwell. I got a few messages today from some indie artists that's worrying about airplanes. So let me say this one more time. At the very beginning of this show, if you are interested in getting your record play and also featured for our new Music Monday, just go to TheBeatDropsRadio.com. Right in the top right in yellow, it says submit your music, follow all the guidelines, make sure it's mixed, mastered, radio ready, clean edit. Clean edit. And we might be featuring you on new Music Monday. I like stuff like that. I like looking forward to giving that opportunity. So keep it locked right here on the Bianca Burwell Show. We're going to have a little upbeat right now. DJ Cassidy featuring R. Kelly, Make the World Go Round. Keep it locked.
contact the Beat Drops Radio and email your YouTube blogger, website, and contact information to thebeatdropsradio@gmail.com to set up an appointment today. Act quickly as we are gearing up for the new year and expanding our network of interesting, creative, fun, original, and captivating shows. And this just might be you. We are a family-friendly top 40 pop and R&B station located in the Atlanta metro area. Now, if you don't live in the Atlanta area and have pre-recorded shows, we have time slots available for you too. Don't delay and email us today, thebeatdropsradio@gmail.com.
You are tuned in to the Bianca Burwell Show. I appreciate everybody for tuning in. The call number is 404-826-9223. Again, 404-826-9223. The listen line, you can listen to any time of the day. 401-347-0418. If you want to see everything that's happening as it happens right here in the station, just go to thebeatdropsradio.com. Click on Watch Live. The Q&A box is open in case you have any questions, comments, stuff like that. In studio guest Vincent Levy Bryant will be coming up in the next segment. BBB! He'll be in the building. But right now, I just wanted to chit chat about a couple things that's on my mind. We've got a couple things. We had some callers on yesterday, and I just want to continue with that just briefly. Ferguson situation. You know, people are on edge right now. Reverend Al Sharpton has said that he is on high alert. And of course, as you know, when you listen to me every day, I always mention that I do listen to Rush Limbaugh just to hear what Rush is talking about. And apparently, you know, Rush, I don't know, he's to me, if you listen to Rush Limbaugh, number one, I listen because I have to be, you know, I'm not partial. I listen to everybody. But I need to know what people are saying across the board. Sometimes I agree with some of the things that he says, and sometimes I do not. And right now, Rush Limbaugh is on a kick about Ferguson being, he's trying to run a parallel of Ferguson and the 1960s. That's where he is right now. And he's revving people up saying that, you know, all of the old heads are coming out saying that, you know, this is our opportunity. And he said that Barack Obama has said that he wishes that he was in the 1960s and this is his opportunity. He also has said that, this is via Rush Limbaugh, that Eric Holder has said the self-same thing. This is, you know, the glory. This is Selma. This is my show and I can say what I want to. So I'm going to say this. Rush has lost his ever-loving mind. I don't know if y'all, have y'all really, a lot of times when people haven't dealt with certain situations in their face, they seem to have a really tore up perception. And by that, I mean this. If you've never, ever, ever in your life ever dealt with somebody being put off by something about you that they don't like, that you've never done anything, you don't know what that's about. You're sitting there like, gosh, I wonder what's wrong with him. Like, what's wrong with them? What do they mean? I have no idea what they're talking about. I'm doing quite well for myself. I have, you know, about 5-6 million listeners, and political people quote me all the time. And, you know, I get all kinds of advertisements and sponsorships, and I get flown all over the place. And it's because I worked hard. That's why I'm doing the things that I'm doing. And if you just work hard, you can get what I get. Negatory. That is not the case for everybody. And like I said, you know, I've dealt with some of those things just by being a female. There are a lot of things that you deal with. And I know other women in business can say the same thing. Also, I used to be a manager of a very popular chain here in Atlanta. I'm not going to give them because they need to pay me. But at any rate, I was with them for 5 years, one of the highest paid multi-unit managers, made a lot. All of my stores hit $1 million the first quarter, by the end of the first quarter. And there were ceilings that I kept hitting. It's not that I wasn't able or capable of doing the job, because I was knocking it out of the park. It didn't matter where they put me. Matter of fact, they called me the fix-it manager. That's what they called me, Miss Fix-It. So anytime there was an area that was lacking in sales, turnover was high, they would send me there, and I would fix the situation and make it profitable. You would want somebody like that, right? That's what I thought. But apparently not. I could not progress any further in that company. They wanted me to stay right there. And, you know, it basically was for I learned that that company seemingly, I'll say it like that, seemingly was geared more towards males, single males, actually, because if you are a female with a family, it's real hard to work 18, 19 hour days on a constant. I work 9 days off one day, work 9 days, you know, off one day, and you end up missing everything in your family. I'm just saying. Now, was I working hard? Yes. But somehow it just didn't seem right when I looked at my paycheck and I looked at the money that I was making for other people. Something didn't seem right. I'm sorry. I'm looking at something going on in the station, y'all. It's funny to me. At any rate, so Rush Limbaugh, you know, I just think that some people do things irresponsibly. And I think that, you know, a lot of people do listen to Rush Limbaugh. It's undoubtedly a lot of people listen to him. And I don't think that he even attempts to look at things from a different perspective outside of his own. And I think that's a problem. I think that's a problem with a lot of people, that if you only want to look at it from one perspective, my parents always taught me, you know, look at it from the other person's perspective first before you pass judgment on something. And also perception and drawing conclusions. I know you've heard this before, but I'll say it again. There have been situations to where you might be walking outside, you look through a glass window, and you see a man and a woman. And all of a sudden, he just hauls off to you from your perspective and hits on her back 2-3 times. You don't know what's going on. Oh my God, he's attacking her. What is going on? But from the perspective in there, she had gotten choked and he was trying to help her. Perspective. Perception means a whole lot from the standpoint of where you are as to what something might mean. And I think too many times we pass judgment on something without understanding everything that's going on with the situation first. Rush Limbaugh had used the word amnesty a lot, and there are a lot of political heads that have mentioned that word, and they've also talked about Rush Limbaugh. Now, me personally, I'll say this, as far as, and you guys know I have no problem, UK is listening hard. It's a lot of y'all, thank you. But I've said this before and I'll say it again. I'm neither Democratic nor Republican. It just depends on who's saying what. And, you know, sometimes my views may go towards a Democrat, but I'm pretty much independent. And the immigration situation, I'm going to be honest with you guys. We just saw an election where, hands down, the Republicans killed it across the board. They did, hands down. And some people wonder, well, the Democrats just did not show up. They just did not come in. They didn't get the support. But I want you to consider a couple of things, and I've been saying this for quite some time, and I'm going to share it again, and maybe you might share the same thoughts, or you might say, Bianca, you're crazy as all get out. I don't know. But here's my thought. When you look at the amount of, we'll just say even young African-American males that have gone to jail for crimes such as marijuana. I'm talking about the thing that now the government has felt like, you know what? We can make money with this. Let's legalize it and tax it, which is some things that have been said for, I don't know, 20 years ago. So you have these a large section of males that have gone to jail. And coincidentally, when you go to jail, when you come out, guess what you can't do? You can't vote. You no longer have the ability to vote. That's gone. Not only do you not have the ability to vote, but trying to find a job is good and horrible. Just put it out there. I know this because I used to be on the end. Like I said, I was one of the highest paid district managers. I hired a lot of those out of jail, and eventually the company put in a policy telling me I could no longer hire them. And I said, why? They said, no, we're not hiring them anymore, because they felt the dynamics had changed and the economy had gotten so bad that they could pull in people with degrees to make menial money and push out those that are trying to get their lives together. I hope you're listening to what I'm saying. But I have seen this time and time and time again, okay? Time and time again. But the reason why I felt like those that have been convicted, especially we, seriously? Okay. I never had a problem with them coming to work. I never had a problem with them being on time. I never had a problem with them doing their job. You know why? Because they had fines they had to pay and they were trying to get back on their feet and they couldn't get a job too much, you know, like anywhere else. So I'd cross-train them and have them doing all kinds of stuff, assisting me in different districts. I'm just saying. They were more reliable to me. But when you brought in somebody who had a degree that felt like, I don't need this, I didn't have too much stability with them. So I'm just putting that out there. So you got a whole section of individuals that could not vote. Let's also talk about immigration and the influx of millions of undocumented individuals, or those just coming over illegally, because I have seen those that have done it the right way. I'm talking about they've come over to the United States, they want to be a citizen, they've taken the classes, they've paid hella money. I just want you guys to know it's not a cheap situation. They pay hella money in order to become citizens of the United States. They've done it, I mean, absolutely by the book. So when you bring in or allow millions of immigrants to come here, guess what they can't do? They can't vote. Why? They're not citizens. They can't drive, they can't vote, and they can't speak the language. So all of those that you might be in favor of, they can't help you at the polls either. I'm just saying. So when you say folks didn't show up, let's just look at that. I don't know. There's a whole lot of people here. And once you start Xing out those that can vote and can't vote, those that can work and can't work, you just start lowering that down quite a significant amount. So I just had to mention that. Also, before I go, because I always try to, in my first segment, especially when I have a guest, a wonderful guest like the one that's coming up, because we are going to talk about a whole bunch of stuff. He's being modest, y'all. Y'all can't see him yet, but he's being real modest. All right, so Bill Cosby. You know, there was a comedian that brought out some things about Bill Cosby. And at first people was like, wait a minute, what are you saying? That Bill Cosby has been accused of, like, by about 14 women, I believe at this point, of rape. 14 women. Some folks said, not Bill Cosby, not the daddy, not Cliff Huxtable. Cliff Huxtable, Mr. Get yourself together, pull your pants up, going around telling people how they need to act, Bill Cosby. But apparently that is the case. Now, Bill Cosby right now, I believe he is 77, and these are things that took place years ago. But it's the point, and the women are saying, how come he was never brought up on any kind of charges? How come it got swept under the rug? Why? Is it because he's Bill Cosby? Some people may argue and say, yeah, that might be the case. You know, uh-oh, our guest has something he might want. But, you know, and now Bill Cosby had something, I believe, in the works. I reported on that earlier where, you know, he was in talks with networks in regards to having another show, you know, come out. And having another show, and, you know, people are like, okay, cool beans. You know, we need that sort of thing. And I love watching the Cosby Show. He ruled Thursday nights for like ever. And even before then, what was that? Fat Albert? Oh my God. Fat Albert, that was the show. We watched Fat Albert. He taught us lessons and, you know, the pudding pops. And I mean, I can go back now. Am I telling my age? I think I am.
Because we know what you're talking about.
But I remember my mom, when she bought those pudding pops, I was like, yeah, we got some pudding pops. And every time the commercial would come on, I would pull out a pudding pop and eat the pudding pop right along with Bill Cosby. And also, Bill Cosby came up in a time where comedians would record albums, and they would put those albums out, and people could purchase those albums. And somebody went back, and they found an album that Bill Cosby put out around the time where all these things so-called took place with these. And he mentioned something about Spanish Fly. And it's called It's True, It's True. Bill Cosby, It's True, It's True. And on in that, he did a part in his act where he said, hey man, you know, there's something that you, if you put it in a woman's drink, she'll just be like, And now you know at this point, they're analyzing everything. Like, so he was doing this and joking about it at the same time? Oh, poor Bill. So now, his new NBC show is no longer in development. That has been taken, and he's been on numerous, well, I'm not gonna say numerous, but a few interviews where some of them have tried to get Bill Cosby to at least say something, and he just smiled and shook his head no, and I guess he felt like silence was golden, but I don't know, Bill, you might wanna say something. I don't know if the charges were, if he settled with them, or, you know, I have absolutely no idea. I have to look at that a little bit further, but it just doesn't look good, Bill. It just doesn't, because this woman after woman after woman after woman that is coming out saying the same thing, talking about him taking them all over the place and staying in his apartment and taking them to shows and then, you know, waking up groggy because and knowing that they had been violated. It's just, it's absolutely crazy, and I hate to see it happened to him. It looked like if he probably would have just been quiet, his legacy would have been intact. But poor Bill. I can't say poor Bill, because the women, you know, they all are pretty consistent, and so far no one has linked any of them together as if they were friends and just got together and said, let's come up with this. But usually if somebody keeps saying the same thing over and over and over again, don't say. Yeah, so we'll be back after this, and we'll have our in-studio guest, Vincent Levy. Right now, Ron Isley featuring Kim, My Favorite Thing. Keep it locked.
Sunday morning inspiration right here on TheBeatDropsRadio.com starting at 9 a.m.
You should be able to hear on
that. Oh, headphones.
Inspiration right here on TheBeatDropsRadio, 9 a.m. Make sure you tune in. Download the TuneIn app so you can take it wherever
you go. Right there like that?
Win the app.
Yes. If you're too hot, I'll adjust
them. Okay. I don't get anything right now.
So you won't.
Okay, that's right.
Three, two. You are tuned into the Bianca Burwell Show on the Beat Josh Radio, your top 40 pop and R&B station, New Beat of Atlanta. The call number is 404-826-9223. Again, 404-826-9223. That is the call number. The listen line is 401-347-0418. And if you want to see everything that's happening as it happens, just go to TheBeatDropsRadio.com, click on the Watch Live tab, and you'll be able to see what's going on. Box is open, but I got all my people tuned in California. What's going on, y'all? And most in particularly, Houston, appreciate you for tuning in because they listen every day while they are work. And I have a wonderful guest in the station with me. Of course, if you've seen all of the promos, I know you've seen my in-studio guest, Vincent Levy Bryant, entrepreneur, composer, musician, songwriter, sound designer, filmmaker, and he grew up in Queens, New York with a father who was a television repairman, you guys, and his mom was a registered nurse. But apparently music was very prevalent in the Bryant household, and almost every family member was playing a music instrument, as you're about to hear his story unfold right now. His mother did his parents did what any parent would do, and that is make sure that they were exposed to all kinds of things, and then something stuck with Mr. Vincent Levy Bryant. So we're going to hear about that right now. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing great.
It's good to have you.
You make me sound like I love. Thank you. First of all, I was going to say thank you. My mother would say, just say thank you.
you heard the voice, didn't you?
Yeah, I heard it.
Just, you know, sometimes I get that too. Sometimes I get that when I go into it. You know, my mom listens every day. I call her the executive producer of the show.
There you go.
Because if things aren't right,
she executive produced you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. My phone will ring. Or she'll send me a text.
Wow.
Or she'll send me an email.
Network.
And that's happened.
Network's calling.
Especially
if you can't say that.
If something wasn't right, you know what I mean?
Right.
If something wasn't right and she felt like it couldn't wait, my phone would ring on the show. And I would like, okay. Everyone just heard that. Sorry, Mom.
That's right. Yeah, you're on the phone with Mom and the world will stop.
Yeah,
because Mom is the word.
And whomever I had in here with me, whenever that happened, they just be like, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I got Mom too, I know. My mother left this earth April the 3rd, 1995, and she's still with me.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed.
So I do hear the voice.
Mm-hmm. That's that indelible impression.
And I don't argue with the voice.
No.
No.
No, that, I don't think that's wise even now.
No. They give you medication and they strap you down. Somebody gets a check every month. You don't see the money.
No, you don't. Not at all. But you grew up in Queens, New York.
Yeah, Springfield Gardens, right in back of Springfield High, 143rd Avenue.
I was telling my son, we were talking about New York. Mm-hmm. You know, I wasn't in Queens. Mm-hmm. I was in Middletown for a little bit. I was trying to decide whether I was going to be in Atlanta or if I was going to be in New York. I love New York. I spent a lot of time in Manhattan, and I spent a lot of time in the Bronx.
I thought you were going to say I spent a lot of money.
No.
That's New York is, I spent a lot of money.
I spent a lot of time because I was trying to decide. You know, I'm really young. But what made me change my mind was the first winner. Was my last winner.
Oh, Jack Frost and his group.
I was good.
His group.
No, I was good.
I can't even talk. I get nervous. I get Jack Frost in my head.
I said this can't this can't work. It's just absolutely too much snow.
Yeah.
And matter of fact, one of my brothers at the time was living in Middletown, and he told me, he said, "Look, if you don't shovel while it's snowing, because we're from Ohio,
we're part of Toledo, Ohio.
Toledo.
My second ex-wife, Toledo.
Is that?
Oh yeah.
You lived in Toledo too?
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You have to shovel while it's snowing to make the mark so you can get back out to shovel more. And there's another thing you can do while it's falling. You can use a broom, a hard whisk broom, and whisk it away and whisk it into pockets. There's little, everybody has little tricks with this.
When I look out that window, Mr. Vincent, I looked out that window and I saw people standing on top of their cars trying to dig out. I said, oh, I'm going south. That's it. I can't do it. This
I'm
not is
not
for me.
Anymore, right.
This is not, I was used to Ohio stuff. I was like, New York, it ain't nothing. No. I can go on up there, but that was my first and last winter.
See, Michigan people who live closer to the lakes get the same thing that New Yorkers get, because the lake effect and the ocean effect is the same thing. You have high humidity, and then you have the snow conditions, which is that powder, that drift. The wind blows like a huge drift, and it'll land wherever it lands.
Are you serious?
And the water makes it much more, the ice more visible, the snow more available. It's more snow. That's what happens. So in 2 hours, you can have the blizzard effect. In 2 hours, you're covered, you're blanketed.
They're talking about 6 feet of snow somewhere, some places up there.
Yeah, well, we just don't want it to come down here.
No,
I don't want to see Cassine Reed with a bunch of dump trucks standing there looking
like, what are we?
You know, what am I doing?
What are we supposed to do?
I love that picture. I got it on my Facebook.
Do you really?
Yeah.
No, that's funny.
Cassine, I like Cassine.
Yeah.
Because he's honest. It's weird to see a politician that's got this honesty that just comes out.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I could kind of tell it's probably some guys that are telling him to chill out sometimes.
Yeah, relax a little bit.
He stood there in that picture and was like, and they let that picture go out, so that picture was authorized. But it's a great picture of him standing with those salt trucks that I know Atlanta doesn't own.
Not at all.
All right, anyway, what's
I'm sorry.
Maybe I'll run for mayor one day.
Yeah.
No, I'm kidding.
Why don't you roll on through? See, unofficially.
Yeah, right.
Unofficially, you guys. You hear this guy?
No, yeah. I'm not. I'm just being really funny. You guys have no worries about me being in politics at all.
He's like,
that's not me. I'll be glad to play at the parties.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. They have budgets.
I do that. Yes, they do.
They got budgets.
The best budgets.
Yeah.
Okay, I get to eat seafood, big Mediterranean shrimp. Oh, yeah, I know.
Full off of one.
That's right.
Where did y'all get this from?
Lobster bisque. Give me that. Yeah, I'm going to play some more. Oh, I'll play that. And anything they request, I know it.
You got it.
Oh, don't even worry about it. I'm playing.
Yes, indeed.
Yep.
So how long did you live in, did your family live in Queens?
When I was 13, in 1972, we moved to Beaufort, South Carolina, to Sheldon, which is a suburb of North Beaufort County, and it's farmland, it is family. It's my mother's family, Robinson Hill. We didn't live far from Robinson Hill, about 2 miles. But the history is real deep, rich, you know, generations and generations. And that whole 9 yards. And the experience and the education and what it did for me and my brothers musically, I can't trade it or think of it in any sense of being, you know, I can't think of me turning out the way I did without that.
I can understand that.
Oh, yeah, in a big way.
When you look back and you see the path that you walked and you realize that, in order for me to be wearing it right now, all these things could not have happened.
No.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
It all had to happen the way that it did.
That's right.
In the manner in order for us to be sitting here right now having a conversation.
All those moments led up to this moment.
Indeed.
And this is a moment collectively with those moments that'll lead to a moment I don't know about.
Right. It still continues.
At the sake of sounding like Oprah.
I like Oprah.
I love Oprah.
You know,
are you kidding
Oprah
me?
We all have our people, and I'm going to ask you about yours too. Somebody who you looked at that you feel like influenced you or had an impression on you. But,
oh, several, including her. Including
Oprah is somebody for me. You know, just being doing what I'm doing.
Right.
And I believe in not blazing a new trail, but look at the one that's already been blazed.
Right.
And what are the things that she did to be successful?
And you can segue off that path to do something.
Exactly.
Yep.
I have a mentor, Dominic Mitchell. I don't know if you know him.
I do know Dominic Mitchell. He's the trainer to the stars. My daughter Yavina was in this program.
Yep. Dominic.
Living in the now, girl. Is.
Yes, indeed. And we're going to play that too.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Okay. I, I don't know how he is with other folks, but as a mentor, he does not hold his tongue.
He does not play.
And if I did something jacked up, he will.
He will jack you up.
Like, you're not going to throw my name around and not be.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, that's
Dominique is a powerhouse. He's a star maker. Mm-hmm. You know, there are people on this planet who have it in them. Mm-hmm. It's a Midas touch, but for them, it's a task. Mm-hmm. And he'll make it your task. But when he gets through with you, you're worthy of what you're doing.
Yeah.
I mean, to be on a stage and entertain is one thing, but to have the oomph, the wherewithal, the goods. Dominique is that dude. He's a drill sergeant, but it works.
Yeah.
It works.
I've seen
him in action out there in Decatur.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. Yeah, awesome yeah. Dude.
He definitely has, and he told me one time before I embarked upon this and I talked to him about it,
mm-hmm.
he said, what's the difference between Oprah, Sally Jesse Raphael, who was that? Geraldo, and it was a few other folks that came out at about the same time. And I thought about it. I said, I don't know. What was the difference? He said, the difference between all of them and Oprah is that Oprah didn't take a salary.
Wow.
She opted to get a percentage of the advertisements and the sponsorships.
She built her brand.
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome.
Is that not awesome?
You see, he's more than that man, you know what? I'm glad you brought him up. I need to get in touch with him for some
things, sure.
And I'm going to be doing that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm in touch with him anyway.
Mm-hmm.
I need him now. About you just sparked mine. See, this is part of what I do. You know, I'm only as good as the people enlist to mm-hmm. associate with what I'm doing, you know, to bring what they have to the table. And I'm not the best micromanager. I'm not the best, you know, business person.
Mm-hmm.
But I know who could play on the team
right.
So we can win. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
And he's definitely one of those team players. He's a VIP.
He is.
That's
awesome. He put me in a situation to really think about that. And, you know, I'll say this real quick, and I got a lot of stuff I want to ask you that you want to talk about.
All right.
But he you know, he put me in a situation because I had just gotten some editing software as far as, you know, the little cheap stuff. You know, I'm trying to do little stuff for the station and at least look halfway decent.
I'll give you a Vegas 13, Sony Vegas 13, yeah. I'm a Sony affiliate. I get software like crazy.
That would be...
Yeah, my nonprofit.
I try to bring that back in.
Yeah. Yeah, Steve Favari, my VP rep up in Chicago, Sony, gives me whatever.
Oh, man, I would appreciate that.
Yeah.
But I have a little something I was trying to figure it out, and he said... because he had a show that he was pitching to the OWN network,
mm-hmm.
and he said, "I need for you to do it." I just opened the box. I don't even know how to.
That's how we do it. That's how we win.
That's
the perfect math. You just got it.
You
don't know how it works. You don't know if you're confident enough to even try. Yes, you're the one.
Oh my gosh! And so I did it, and he sent it to him. And when he called me, I was scared to death. My heart was beating. He said, "You want to know what they said?" I was like, "You want to know what they said?" I said, I guess. I'm scared to death. He said, because music, I searched long and hard to make sure I had the right music to hit at the right spots, you know, to
break
up. You know, I try to act like I'm sitting in the theater. What would I want to see?
Right.
And that's all I could think about.
I identify with that.
And he said that first thing they said was, "Where did she find that music?"
Wow.
I said, "Really?" He said, "We... excellent. We want to see more throwing up, though." But they told me I did good. I was like, "Really?
You're in.
I did good."
You're in.
No idea. I probably couldn't even duplicate what the heck. I just was like,
and see, that's
see what this does.
Now that's another key that tells you how blessed and how on the right track you are. You can redo that. You couldn't make that happen if you tried, because you were in the spirit to be the one to do that. So it wasn't a thing where you could just go, "Oh, I watched it. I'll pull a rabbit out of my head," whatever. You know?
Right.
No,
mm-hmm.
that's what's up. That's how I live. I'm just saying. You know, I just said this to Carmen Reed. She's mm-hmm. a cordon bleu chef. I'm co-executive producing her cooking show.
Mm-hmm.
And we're in the early stages. We had a meeting this morning with awesome, awesome dude. Kendall Minter. Drop that name. Kendall Minter is an entertainment attorney.
Yes.
For entertainment attorneys. He's that dude.
Wait a minute.
He is that dude.
He's the entertainment attorney.
He is an entertainment attorney for entertainment attorneys.
Well, all right.
And let me just say, that was part of what I was talking to Carmen about. I says, you know, the things I do, I don't sweat over. Mm-hmm. But when I know that I'm sweating, I know I shouldn't be doing it. Mm. Because it's I'm chosen to do it, and I'm doing it. Mm. It's already together.
Right.
And my, you know, faith without works and all that, I have all of that in me. So mm-hmm. I know what's going on. Mm-hmm. So if I don't belong in a place, I don't belong there. And certain mm-hmm. things happen, and there's, you know, things are weird, and mm-hmm. things are, and it's more than just an uncomfortable situation. It's the situation that says, this is not where you belong. Mm. That's not what you're supposed to be doing.
Right.
So I don't want to say things come easy to me, but things come easy to me. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. That's it. So yeah, everybody has that. Everyone can tap into that infinite energy, mm-hmm. call it what you want, God, the mm-hmm. universe, Hashem, whatever you want to call it, but it is there, and it doesn't mind. It doesn't have an ego. Mm-hmm. But it's always been there, mm-hmm. and it's infinite. It is endless. Mm-hmm. So if you can tap into it and keep it flowing and make it happen,
right.
and it's with everything you do, mm-hmm. everything you do.
Wow.
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
I mean, I'm passing it along. I just started discovering this and really working it too. Mm-hmm. I'm still kind of, you know, like, am I in the right place? I'm always checking and balancing. Well, not to the point of paranoia. You can get, you know, but mm-hmm. you get a sign, you get a place, and a person will say something. And someone who has no idea, you'll just run into them, and they'll say and pick up where what you just went through left off.
Exactly.
And that's how you know.
That's how you know.
How my life has been. It's weird, you know, like Forrest Gump, you know.
Right, right.
There it is. Need I say more?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
I wanted to ask you about, you play a lot of instruments.
I play keyboards, piano. I'm a pianist. My dad was a piano player. I play drums because my brother Chuck, mm-hmm. Charlton Kevin Bryant, he's in Lovejoy, Griffin, mm-hmm. and he is a drummer, and his son is an awesome drummer and piano player too. My brother Joey, you'll say, played bass, mm. and we played each other's instruments because we were, hey, he's playing my instrument, he's playing my, I don't want to hear that, my okay. baby. I don't want to hear that, you, he's playing yours, go play his. Mm. And we were kids, so that kind of, that ended that whole argument. My dad could play 7 instruments, I mean, he could wow. grab anything and just make music. He's going to music store. Turn it right out.
Yeah, I saw a video of you and in a music store playing. Yeah, I did. It's on social media.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's on the Facebook.
I said, well, all right. He sat down and said, I'm about to do this.
I'm going to tell you what happens with that real quick. Mm-hmm. I'm in a music store and I'm trying out new keyboards, the technology, the sounds, to see how good these samples sound. And, you know, playing a sample-based instrument is my real forte. Mm-hmm. I was on the forefront of all this in the late 70s before they were sampled. Mm. You had synthesizers that, you know, our thing was to tune it all in right, the oscillators, mm-hmm. the low frequency oscillators and mm-hmm. everything, the attack, decay, sustain, release. Anyway, I'm in the music store and sometimes I get an inspiration and it hits me mm. and this song will come out and I'm hearing this movement, you know, mm-hmm. because I score for film as well. Mm-hmm. And so I say, I'm going to get this down. And if someone's with me with a, you know, will take my phone and camcorder me playing mm-hmm. it and get some good audio, then I've got the song idea and I'm trying out the instrument. Mm. And it doesn't hurt for Guitar Center to see that they're here. They're getting free advertising. I'm with Guitar Center.
Yeah.
You know,
that's enough.
Yeah. You're not paying me. No, I don't
I care. Second
it's,
that.
It's a great
experience. I'd love the endorsement though.
Well, who knows how it's gonna work, you know.
Just saying. That'll be really great.
But when I go to the music store, it's still the same. I'm still that kid in a candy store, mm-hmm. you know. I go to a toy store, I don't feel the same way. I was never that toy store kid.
No?
I'd be like, oh, we're going to the music store. God. Oh, my little brothers were the toy kids, you know. Uh-huh. I have a baby brother, Greg. He's my baby brother. He's more grown than I am.
How many siblings do you have?
I have the four of us with my mom and dad, and I have an older brother, okay, and he's got music in him too, but he doesn't play an instrument. He was always good at knowing what music, picking what music. He understands music well. And, you know, he didn't have the same experience growing up that we did mm-hmm. because we had our dad right there at reach. And he's older and didn't get to go through that experience. Mm. My youngest brother didn't have the experience because he pretty much chose not to for some reason.
Oh.
And forget it. He's the responsible one.
Okay. He's the responsible
He's
one?
He's the responsible okay. 25 years in the Air Force. Oh, wow. 8 years in NATO. Works for Verizon Federal. I don't want to talk too much about him. You know, because it's about me. You know.
Yes. We are talking to you today.
I don't want to talk about any of my brothers now. And I go into a music store, and I'm a kid in a candy store, you know, and the guys in there know me from the different ones I go to.
Yes.
And I always get to the point about what it is I'm really after, or I don't bother them. I just go in and play. Mm. And sometimes it's therapeutic, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I have my own rig and my studio and my band and, mm-hmm. you know, blah, blah, blah. But to go in a music store is a whole different experience.
Mm-hmm.
It's a thing that feeds you and gives right. you inspiration. It's just like me walking onto the Woodruff Art stage
mm-hmm.
with a friend of mine who would allow it. I'm hanging out with them.
Mm-hmm.
And they say, you like this piano? You like this knife? It's fine. We sit down and play it. And if it's really tuned well,
that's it.
Everything is tuned out and I'm playing.
Mm-hmm.
And people are like, that's awesome or whatever. Or who's that? Or, that's great. I appreciate that. But
What type of genre would you put yourself in? Because you're pretty widespread. You don't have just one particular.
No, I don't. I didn't grow up that way.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there are certain, if I was going to pick something, gospel jazz is it. It's fun to play. And I grew up with some serious jazz mentors.
Mm.
And my dad was a blues jazz person.
Oh, really?
He was never a real, he listened to jazz. I'm 8 years old and I loved Amma Jamal. Mm. And I loved Oscar Peterson and McCoy Tyner.
Mm.
And I understood the mechanics and the technique and I could mimic that and Jimmy Smith.
Mm-hmm.
But my dad felt, I don't know if he felt this, I shouldn't say felt, but he never ventured to play that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it was more complicated than what he wanted to try to do.
Huh.
But he was an awesome jazz, gospel, and blues player.
Yeah.
And soul music, you know, at the time we had Wilson Pickett and,
yeah.
you know, that kind of stuff going on. And, mm-hmm. You know, just my experience with music really took a turn at 9 years old when I got classical training for
wow.
2 years. My mother was like, you need to play a little more than that.
At nine?
Yeah, at nine. And that's what that turned it
that's
out.
That's phenomenal.
The Hannon book. The Hannon book of arpeggios. And I just got crazy with that book. It just got, you know.
I think it's amazing when a parent can kind of be instrumental in allowing their child to connect with whatever that passion is at an early age.
That's our job. That's a parent's
you
job.
You know, I think that it's just like phenomenal.
Someone said to me the other day, it is phenomenal. I was told the other day, and this really broke me down. We're not supposed to have our kids live our dreams or what we want them to be.
Mm-hmm.
We're supposed to help them discover what they're made wow. to do and what they're here to be and encourage that and nurture that and make
mm-hmm.
that. And when it hit me, it's, you know, because I have some very talented children. And
mm-hmm.
one by one, I have been, I've been disappointed because mm-hmm. I wanted to see them be that next generation. Of
like, but where is
my son? My son, Jason, he shreds on the guitar. He's awesome. And he's into
mm-hmm.
metal, which is something
mm-hmm.
I'm like. But now he's in airborne school, officer school at the
mm-hmm.
In the Army. My daughter, Yavina, she's an environmentalist
mm-hmm.
and she's in human resources. You know, that's her career. And she's like, Daddy, I think that's who's singing the Now song. But she's
mm-hmm.
a great writer and awesome singer and producer. My daughter, Sarah, plays the piano, writes songs, runs her little studio rig. She's a great writer and not a bad singer. But she can write the hit songs. And
wow.
they wrote and did the Now, they did the vocals and produced the Now song together. I wrote the music. But I'll tell you something, they don't care about being in the business at all.
They're like, they can do it or not do it.
Plus, they watch the internet and they're scared of things they see on the internet. You know, all these
really?
Different little weird things on the internet talking about the dark forces behind the music industry. So, you know, anyway, who knows?
Yeah.
There's dark forces behind every industry. Look at Monsanto and what's going on. You got to watch what you eat today.
Yeah, you do. You do. It's
anyway.
Absolutely crazy. I talk about that, too.
Yeah, and I said all that to say, you know, one by one I had to let go and just, you know, say, okay, I've got to understand this is what you're into. This is what you're doing. And you got my blessings and my support.
Well,
and that let me do my thing more. So now I don't have to worry about but them. Now it's all about me.
You spoke of Yavina, right? Am I saying it right?
Yavina? Yes, you are.
And I happen to have Living in the Now. And
I do. Yavina the PYT.
So we're gonna play that real quick. It's produced by yourself.
Written by I produced the music with a partner. Shad Callender knows the information. And let me tell you something. We did this track for another artist, and Yavina took the song and took it to a new level. I was on my birthday vacation, and I was celebrating my birthday, let's just say. And the engineer called and said, Vince, the girls are in the studio. They said, you're not coming. And I was like, yeah, okay, no, never mind. Let them go. Just call me back and let me know how they're doing. He calls me back 2 hours later. He says, man, they your girls. They know what they're doing. All right, man, this is awesome, man. And before they was talking about you. It's like, what they say? Man, we can do this. Daddy don't need to be here. Don't even call him. Did you call him? I was like, wow. And I listened to it, and then I took it and had it mixed. And I gotta tell you something. I mean, I gotta tell you a lot of things, but that, let me tell you, they know what they're doing. And after we had the mix done, it was Aaron Campos did the mix and tightened up the vocals a little. He said, those girls are on the mark, man. This is that classic stuff. I says, okay, thank you. Let's go to the next level.
Well, we're going to play it right now.
Thank you.
All right.
All right.
Yavina, Living in the Now. We'll be right back after this.
Wow. Listen to that applause.
Yeah. That's pretty hot, right?
It is. I really think the world of that song. That song's my, that song would be my personal get up and go get 'em song.
Really?
I told her this just the other day. She had no, she understands a little bit. And they know that daddy's super sensitive. I'm a sensitive guy. Yeah, I'm a big pushover sometimes. But that song, there were mornings I did not want to get up.
Mm.
I didn't want to get out of my warm bed into the cold or whatever. And I put that song on, put my earbuds in, and it's on. I got my, had my Bluetooth earbuds in. I'm in the shower. And I'm like, okay, got to do this. Then I take them and throw them out and then do the rest of the shower and get out, shave, and walk the about 16 blocks to catch the bus in the cold in Atlanta. And that song would be in my ears, and I'd say, I can do this. Mm-hmm. The next thing I know.
How long did it take me to produce that track?
The song was an idea, like I said, it came up, we worked with a friend of ours at SAE, loved that school, and we worked with an intern recording engineer, and that was LG, he's in Los Angeles now, but knows the information, Sean Callender, and I wrote the track, we did the track, he did the drums, and I did the instrumentation, and we did the production and the editing together, and the hook, I came up with the hook, then we had Yavina come in and sing it. And he was surprising us. He surprised us. And she came in and did the track. She was just, this was 3 years ago. She did the hook and living in the now, living in the now. I don't like that, Daddy. I don't like that. Let's change it. I says, let's do it. Let's do what she wanted. But we kept what we wanted. It's one thing. You work with an artist. You know you're onto something. Let them get out their creative angst and then we can work. Maybe she's coming up. She's coming up with something. We did. And what we settled on was living in the now. Which was close to what we both wanted. Then from there, it was almost a year later, because we did multiple tracks. We did tons of tracks. I have tons of music. And we revisited the song with a new mix. And I went to go have my birthday. And I'm celebrating my birthday on Hilton Head Island. I am drunk.
Oh, no.
The phone rings. It's LG. And he goes, Vince. And I told the story already, and you know the rest, and there you go. So how long did it take? About a year, about a year.
Okay, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Can you take us back to that musical journey? And because you have a lot of individuals that you work with.
Tons.
And you know, the Curtis Mayfield thing, I was like,
oh, that
I was on the floor.
Yeah.
I was trying to tell my pop about it.
Yeah.
You know, so my pop, he's a musician. He plays the keys. He plays the tenor, alto, and soprano sax.
Wow.
That's
awesome. He plays sax and plays keys. I bet he is awesome in voicing chords, and he plays the organ. And I knew that.
I saw some old pictures, like way back when they were like touring around doing the Chitlin circuit.
My dad did it.
The conk in the head?
Yes.
Like real skinny?
Yes.
I'm sorry, he's probably going to be killed.
That's what they did, but that was their look. I look at these hip hop kids, and I ain't mad at them, except for presenting themselves in a what we call the mainstream. You have to dress a certain way. You have to be able to speak. It's important, and you have to carry yourself. But the hip hop culture has its own art form expression, just like bebop, just like rock and roll, just like rockabilly, just like country. They all have their own expressions, but back to a subject you talked about earlier that really doesn't have nothing to do. I'm a father. When I see our young men, they don't know how to interact with mainstream. They don't know because they haven't been taught systematically. They haven't been taught. You know, I taught my sons, you don't wear your pants on your butt here.
Right.
You go do that with your friends in your space. You do that.
Mm-hmm.
But here you don't do it. And when someone of authority talks to you, you're talking to me right now. You're not talking to some that you can blow off. Especially someone with a gun and a badge.
Right, exactly.
You have nothing to say.
Because
I want you to come home to me.
Right.
You see? Now the science behind that is you're not losing no points. You're not being less cool. You're not being less pretty. You're not being dead.
Right.
So, what's your big deal? You have nothing to prove, except that you can conform. Now, if it's a person who's doing the wrong thing, that's where I come in. That's where we can find out what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
But we can't do much after you're dead.
No.
Because someone doesn't understand what their real authority and what their real job is.
That's right.
That's it, in a nutshell. I am not mad. I'm disappointed. When I looked at Trayvon's picture,
yes,
I lost my marbles. Because he looked like my son.
17.
I lost my marbles.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, I looked in his face and all, I could see Jason.
Mm-hmm.
I could see Chuck. I could see Ian easily.
Mm-hmm.
Easily.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like.
And you're dealing with those that can really care less.
Yeah.
They just categorize and put them in a. And, you know, I mean, even trying to express to my son, when you dress a certain way or act a certain way.
You're targeting yourself.
You know, they can care less about the kind of individual I know. I know my son. They don't know that.
They don't.
You're in a category.
You're in a category.
Automatically.
They are assuming. They're assuming, mm-hmm. and then they begin, now I'm going to talk their language.
Mm-hmm.
Then they begin flexing on y'all.
Mm-hmm.
And they're fronting because now they've got, you're fronting who you think you are to them in their mind, and that front becomes a bigger stage.
Mm-hmm.
And they have something you don't have.
Mm-hmm.
Authority.
That's right.
A gun and a badge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true.
I'm not hating on the police. The police have a job to do.
They do have a job to do, and there are plenty that do an excellent job.
And just like in any business, you have good job people and bad
and
job
people.
Some are having a bad day, and that bad day may translate into a bad day for the rest of your life.
Yep. You're right about that.
That's it.
Man. So do you feel like music... and the love for music and the passion for it kept you out of harm's way coming up?
Yeah, in a lot of ways, yeah, because it was part of my dad's whole thing was stay in the yard.
Mm-hmm.
Stay in the house. You got plenty to do. And he didn't have to say it often because we loved what we were doing. We had a whole basement with equipment in it, and I was in heaven. You know, my childhood was a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
And we had the equipment, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I got to show you these old home movies I got.
Please do.
Yeah,
please do
this stuff. I gotta see
this. Please do.
And you'll see. I mean, what I'm talking about. Some people they're so blown away if I start talking like they're like, no way. How do you know all these people? You don't know all these people. You never met these people. You say you always talking about you know this and here. You don't know anybody. Just shut up. And when I meet people like that, what I often do is just shut down because I say to myself, wow, Vince. That's like pulling up in a Bentley
mm-hmm.
and a person's at the bus stop.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
So yes.
I have to watch myself.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a warning. I don't get.
Is that though? Because I've come across those that have doubted people that I've met. And really, I could see for what reason, I don't know, but like I'm going to lie about the situation.
Right.
But you don't know this person, you don't know that person. You don't have this. You don't have this many listeners or that, whatever. And a friend of mine, Tony Sanders, he's the A&R over at Spectrum, Monarchy. And he said, Bianca, you need to put a wall of fame up of all the people.
That you met.
Now, I only put a few. I got so many of them.
I do that now.
You know, I was like, well, let me start putting stuff up so I guess people will walk in like,
right.
No.
Right.
You know what I mean?
See, sometimes I want to go through my Facebook picture. But then there's private ones that I won't show you me in a picture with this person because certain people think because I'm with that person or I'm around that person or I know that person or I'm in a picture with that person
mm-hmm.
that I can get you to that person or I think I want to have the time or take the time to take you to that person,
mm-hmm.
which most of the time is no.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you know it, Giselle. Oh my God. You know, hey, calm down. We're not buddies. I don't know his phone number.
Mm-hmm.
He's married.
Yeah.
He don't want you. He ain't thinking about me. He ain't thinking about me.
Uh-huh.
You know, so you know damn hell. Stop, calm down. I just met him.
Uh-huh.
There's nothing going on there. I'm not going to do a movie with him. There's
mm-hmm.
nothing. I'm not an actor.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
So tell me about if you would do me the honor.
Uh-huh.
And share the story about how you met Kurt Smith. I would
Bill Fuller, William Fuller, one of Atlanta's top-notch architects. This man is so, he's more modest than you think I'm modest. He's really modest. And it's nothing's, he designed a house for Little John's parents. Oh, God, who he didn't do things for. Anyway, let me just cut to the chase. He's more connected in this city, and he's the most modern. Now, that's who should run for mayor. Hmm. But he took me to Curtis's house in 1984. It was winter, January, right after New Year's, 1984. Hmm. Because I wanted to see what a recording studio in someone's home looked like, because I want to build one. I mm-hmm. couldn't afford one. Mm-hmm. And no, I don't have a Bentley. Okay?
Hey, let me get this right.
Right, let me get this straight. I'm not pulling up to the bus stop in a Bentley or anything. I don't even own a car. Anyway, so now back to it. Now we got that.
Which we good.
We got, I need his number because, no. Okay, so anyway, I get there and I don't know it's Curtis. I didn't know he was taking me to Curtis's house. Mm-hmm. Because I guess he knew the weight of what it was, because mm-hmm. he knew that I was into music and obviously to him talented enough. So he takes me there and I'm sitting down and Curtis Mayfield comes in. Hey dude, how you doing? I'm like,
you oh my fall God. Out. Were you about to hit the
phone? I was like, yeah, I was like. Hi, I'm piano. I mean, Vince, I play the piano. I mean, you got a studio and you're Curtis, man. You're a super fly. You know, I was like, yeah, I was losing my mind. And he knew it. He's used to that. So he's like, well, this is the studio. And he's like, okay, just see the studio. So I still the studio. And now I'm like, I'm looking at the door. I completely forgot why I was there.
Oh, no.
And then I saw the Steinway piano and I sat down and started playing. So, he's like, you know, hey dude, I want to use you. I'm going to Europe. But I want to put you in my bed. I want to use you. I think you're good. And I was like, wait a minute. You're Curtis Mayfield. That's enough. You want me in your bed? I was like that. I was like that guy in Harlem Nights. Honey, I'm never coming
never
home.
Come home.
I'm yes so serious. Yes oh no, you don't know. And that's what it was. That's how it was. And he knew that too. So he was cool. And I got to meet my fellow bandmates. And it was I look back and it really hasn't that was a defining moment.
How was that phone call to the parents? Like
my dad and me were on the phone and he was so nervous. Cause you know, like I said, the guy was hands-on with us. He was raising us. So he was like, you could listen, okay, we're coming up there. You know, my dad talked, when he got excited, he had a slight stutter. Mm. We're coming up there, me and Pearl, and don't do nothing until we get there. Cause, you know, I'm like, well, what am I gonna do? I don't want you doing no drugs or nothing. I said, I'm not doing any drugs. I'm like, Dad, we're not doing drugs. It's Curtis Mayfield, I'm playing his music, dude. I'm doing super fly, give me your love, I'm on the piano, I'm playing. He's like, yeah, I know the album, boy, you know. So my dad tried to show up from Buford, South Carolina, from Shelby. Uh-huh. And, you know, he and my mother just wanted to see her son. My mother bought me, by the way, my mother, I was 11 when Superfly came out in New York City.
Uh-huh.
And my mother bought the album for us when, let me get this straight now. Came out then, but she bought the album when we moved to South Carolina for us. She had bought it before that. She bought the single because she thought it was a great anti-drug message. Okay. Freddie's dead. Yeah.
Okay, okay.
And she goes, do you know what Freddie died from? That's what my mother was, the blackest Jewish mother I ever
is
had.
That right?
You'll ever know what you would have ever known in your life. She says, do you know what Freddie died from? I was like, drugs. Heroin. It's like, okay, Mom, okay.
Okay.
You ought to never, ever even look at heroin. Have you ever seen it? No, you better not. And Freddie's Dead was ingrained, and it was like, but the music was. Mm. But we were onto the message, you know. The woman was smart. She was like, so she just wanted to meet Curtis, and she met him, said hi. And my dad took over, and she was like, Vincent, you, she's feeling my lymph nodes. This is an RN. She's like,
the medical. Yeah, she's trying to make sure that you're good.
How's your asthma? I'm okay, Mom. It's no asthma. This is good. You smell air. It's clean. You know, we're weird. That's how it is. You know, it's always worried about a sick kid. You know, because I think I touched on, I had nephritis when I was 11.
Yes.
Missed the fifth grade. And she just did her thing. Put me in the Queens Branch Library Film Club. And,
film Club, yes.
Yeah. Red Balloon was my favorite film. And so now, back to that time, when with Curtis Mayfield, you know, they meet and everything's cool. And my parents, my dad was like, okay, and I heard him tell Curtis, I don't want him with none of the drugs. I don't want him to come back here with no habits, nothing. Mm-hmm. And Curtis understood and was like, yeah, man, don't worry. I'm Dave. He's my son. When I take him out there, all of them are my sons. And that is how he treated us.
Really?
Totally.
He was like,
he was not a joke. Educating and was on our case. Mm-hmm. Totally. About everything. Okay.
Wow.
And I was a newlywed at the time.
Oh, wow. Age.
So he was really.
Like, so how was that? I mean, because there's a lot of musicians right now that being married and in the entertainment. Yeah, that just.
I'm shaking my head right now. I don't want to talk about that.
That sometimes just doesn't work too well.
Yeah. Yeah. But you know something? Here's what does work. When two people, I don't care who you are, and you agree. Mm-hmm. On each other, everything and anything is a possibility.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's all I want to say.
Man, yeah. Curtis Mayfield.
Yes,
phenomenal.
Spent 2 years around the man. We did that tour, England, Holland, and Japan in 2.5 months. I was in the studio with him. I'm gonna get you, sucker. Wayans brothers, Keenan Wayne, mm-hmm. Keenan Ivory Wayans. And Ice-T and just Antonio Fargas.
Mm-hmm.
I got, it was awesome. Who I did not get to meet.
That is hot.
It was. And they sent the film out to him. He scored it, most of it, wrote that stuff in his house.
Mm.
And I was around Carlos Glover. And, you know, I was just glad to be just buzzing around like the fly on the wall or something.
Yeah.
And
I'm feeling the excitement right now.
You know? Yeah.
That's some exciting stuff. I just want you to know you are very inspirational.
Thank you.
You are very inspirational.
If there's anything I can do, I'm going to do that.
Man.
I just believe anybody can do what it is. Mm-hmm. If you're thinking of something you can do it, just do it. That's why you're thinking of it.
Mm.
That's why it's a thought, because somewhere it's real. Now, what you have to do is channel it through your actions to make it real, because this world really is 99% fake anyway.
Mm.
Only 1% is real. Mm. And this physics scientists and everybody else, they're all proving that now.
Yes.
Talking about we live in a holographic universe.
Yeah, holographic. And, yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know? So
stuff that people
there's some truth to that stuff.
Yeah, it is.
It's just like how I get my music. I pull frequencies out of the air. I don't even want to say that. Frequencies come to me out of the air.
Mm-hmm.
And once they get into a pattern, it becomes music. And I'll hear something in my head, or I'll touch the piano and get a certain vibration out of the key, and I'll sing that key, and I'm playing. That's where my ear and my soul take over. And when it comes to writing it, it's a whole nother story. Orchestrating is a whole nother story. Arranging is a whole nother story. You know? That's like the genetics that make a child look like you.
That's right.
You're making a child, you can make the act happen, but then there's science and the DNA and the RNA, and then there's spiritual, and all these things go into that. I'm still learning to.
Yeah, coming together to make what is to be.
To be.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, I mean, I take my music seriously, because I said this to somebody, and I don't mean to belittle anything else in my life, my world. I love my children. Mm-hmm. All of them. Do you know something, though? My music has been the most valuable thing in my life.
Mm-hmm.
Because at the end of the day,
mm-hmm.
it's all I ever really needed and had. Mm-hmm. That was, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
To sit down, to feel a certain way and sit down and play and then feel healed or happy, joyous, mm-hmm. and to make someone else feel healed, happy, joyous.
That's right.
From you, that's a gift, and that's something. It's just like anybody that grows a rutabaga or okras or whatever, or makes or builds or frames a house or does a painting or a radio show. You know, you're doing something. Somebody's got to get that in a positive and be able to take that and go on to do their thing better.
Right. We're gonna take a break.
Wow.
We're going to take a break. We'll come right back after this. Curtis Mayfield, The Makings of You. We'll be back after this.
Oh, wow. I love this song. his son Kurt.
Hello, I'm Ronald Hatcher, Aaron Hatcher's father. Aaron has muscular dystrophy and cerebral palsy.
I'm Rita Gray from Betty White's Off Their Rockers, and unfortunately, he's no longer with us now. Each year, thousands of cases go unreported where children with disabilities and special needs get abused in their schools. Our mission is to protect the child as well as the teachers.
This is going to go fast. I'm going to try to get it all in.
Okay, you got it.
And promote safety by donating to cause of Aaron Hatcher's They Can't Talk But We Can in P.O. Box 2392, Roswell, Georgia 30077. Or visit our website at theycanttalkbutwecaninc.org. Let's not have another loving, innocent child like Aaron die. Remember, they can't talk, but we can.
You are tuned in to the Bianca Burwell Show, and I'm sitting here with my wonderful guest, Vincent Levy Bryant. I appreciate you so much for coming on and just sharing so much with me.
Thank you. I appreciate you having me here. I'm still not used to all that. Okay. I'm just a regular guy. I put my shoes on one toe at a time like everybody else.
Very talented guy, though. And that just doesn't come to everybody. That's a gift. You know, that you've been given. Not everybody has that, you know? And it's just, it's so much I got to fit in these last 12 minutes, but we're going to do it.
Wow.
Yeah.
12
minutes.
Like 12 years.
As far as, like, you know, we already covered you being a composer, a musician, songwriter, sound designer. What is that?
Sound designer is a guy that uses certain sounds, sound ambience, sound effects to help tell the story in a film, set the mood for a scene. Sound design is the guy that he has to have, you know, the requirement really isn't to be musical, but to be able to use sound in a rhythmic way to help pull the pace of the story up to up to an emotional level, so you can feel the story being told, you know, the characters doing their thing, the actors and whatnot, the way a certain car door sounds, the way a certain particular sound that a character is identified with, you know, like quirky type sounds.
Right.
In The Matrix, you always had this weird electric buzzing sound.
I love Matrix.
Yeah, and the strings, you know. But those are samples that can be manipulated. And I played with sounds, you know, playing with early synthesizers back in the day. I worked at Carol's Rehearsal Halls, and I worked for Bill Sonnenberg way back. Did all the rentals and the carding for NBC, Saturday Night Live, and all the studios in New York. That's how I had to meet everybody. I'm walking into
that's like excellent.
Yeah, it was one of the greatest experiences.
Well, how did that happen for you?
I'm an electronics technician. I grew up, my dad was a TV repairman, so I had everything at my disposal. And I learned the business of repair from a teenager, just like the piano. And I was in love with it because it supported and it was related to music. So, you know, you got to know how to fix your amp. You got to know how to fix your keyboard, tune your keyboard. I had a Fender Rhodes piano. You got to know how to tune
Fender Rhodes. Man, you took me back.
Yeah.
I love that sound of a Fender.
My dad gave me his Sparkle Top 73 key Fender Rhodes piano. I was 11. And it really wasn't mine, but he would let me play it, play with my brothers in the band. It was his piano he used to keep it. And but he literally gave it to me once we moved down to South Carolina. He had no more use for it. So here it's yours. So, and that was, you know, I was 13 and I was like, wow. But yeah, the electronics thing is something that it was a career. You know, I was 14 years old, and I had the car installation biz. And Beaufort, South Carolina, the Marine Corps Air Station, all those Marines in the 70s.
Yes.
And car stereo was first coming out. I was putting big speakers and 25 watt amps in a car to enhance the sound.
Right.
And big house speakers in a guy's little Toyota Celica. Before these Marines, they would just love me.
I'm sure they did.
Yeah,
they were like, get that guy.
Three, four cars every other weekend. And that's what I did. And that's how I had my money. These kids that do their little things or whatever, they're doing, oh, I'm making money this weekend. No. I was making that kind of money. I was 14, and it was legitimate.
Right.
I was working really hard.
And how did that segue into you working for?
Oh, Bill. I answered an ad. I was looking for a job. I'm in New York City and staying with my Uncle Harold and Aunt Gail. And I'm like, you know, and I answered an ad in the Village Voice for an electronics technician, must have music background, and not music, but must have music instrument repair experience. So wow. I'd go down there.
Oh, that's
me. And I meet Bill Sonnenberg, you know, older Jewish man. He was like, takes me into the shop and says, three amps on the bench. Go ahead. Let me see what you can do.
That's probably how I sounded too.
He did sound like that. I love these people. Bill and Ethel Sonnenberg. I don't know where you are now, but you know, Bill had a pacemaker at that time. You know, I endeared myself to people easily. Mm. That's what I mean. If I know I'm in the right spot, everything's cool. Mm. And we were like fam. We were like family. And so soon he got to trust me to run rehearsal. This was a rehearsal hall. Mm. Everybody, if you were going to play on Saturday Night Live, they'd set you there to rehearse.
Mm. Wow.
So I worked with the Rolling Stones.
Oh, that's
yes. For the 1979 show on Saturday Night Live, they did Beast of Burden. Mm-hmm. And I did their rehearsal mix and all that, all the equipment. Yeah. Stevie Wonder. Lonnie Liston Smith.
Really?
Chic. Yes. Chic. Paul Simon, Richard T, all of that. Steve Gadd, all that. Mm. You know. So to make a long story short, that I don't do all because you just 12 minutes. Anyway, and I can repair the stuff, set it up, play the stuff, and you know, I got a great Ronnie Foster story. He is the keyboard player for George Benson and several others.
Okay.
Ronnie, I hope you hear the story. I'm a young kid, I'm in the studio, Quincy Jones is producing the George Benson section. Mm-hmm. I had met Quincy through Ollie Cotton. It was a brief and that was great, but I'm carting this equipment and I hook up this Mutron pedal backwards to this Fender Rhodes piano and Ronnie loses it. Mm. He ain't working, kid, you don't know what you're doing, blah, 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 expletive. And I lost my marbles and I went in the bathroom and I had the biggest cry because I was like, I blew it, Vince, you didn't blow the keyboard up. He's losing his mind, but I didn't say it. You couldn't say it. I'm a kid, you know.
Right, right.
So I come out and I got my act together. And I see Quincy's and they're talking to him. Mm-hmm. So later on, David Silverman, we became good friends. He comes and tells me, goes, you know what Quincy was telling him? He said, man, that's the kid. All he did was hook it up backwards. You ain't going to be losing your mind. Anyway, blah, blah, blah. But we're friends now, me and Ronnie. We're friends.
Really? That's cool.
Yeah. But he's, that was one of those things that was like, this is the real deal. Pay attention to what you're doing. Mm-hmm. Because all they need to do is come in and play. What you need to do is make sure it's playable. Mm. So I became a technician for several people. Howie, oh God. Sorry, Howie, I'm losing your last name. He was a keyboard player for Crown Heights Affair and the Strikers. Mm. He had a big hit out called Body Music. Mm. And I can't tell you how many hits the Crown Heights Affair. This was the height of the disco era, and these guys were that band. Mm-hmm. I was his keyboard technician, and I became the assistant road manager for the Strikers. Donnie Linton gave me my first real heavyweight industry job. God bless the dead. Donnie Linton, God bless you in heaven. I hope everything is wonderful in the afterlife. But trusted me, gave me a job, gave me responsibility, and I became their sound man as well. And Willie Skip Slaughter introduced me to the Strikers and Howie and all these guys. Willie Skip Slaughter, Bo Brown, Ruben Rodriguez, Ruben Faison, the lead singer, Daryl Gibbs, and Bobby Gilliam. We just had a great time on the road. It was a great experience. Back in my young fly days, as my daughter Yavina calls me, Daddy, we ain't gonna get young and fly like that. I said, when you become a big hit and I can afford the plastic surgery, then I'll get fly like that. But my best experience is, you know, because I was a technician, I could always repair stuff. So I was a handy person to, you know, I knew how to solder, I knew how to diagnose and troubleshoot, I knew how to call ahead for parts, go to Radio Shack and get it, and fix it. And it would work, and they would like, No, 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 you're not going away. And a lot of times the road managers would be like, you eating steak tonight. They going to eat hamburger. I was like, no, no, you can't.
You made it work, though.
Man, you ain't charging none of you. Just, I said, well, I'm here. That's what I do, you know. So that's
phenomenal.
Thank you. I just was there doing what I do.
But that's just phenomenal. Opportunities like that. Just like we said before, you never know what that's going to lead you to.
I never get that until I compare myself to somebody else. Okay? When I look at, I go, because I look at these young sound kids today, and I go, you don't know how to solder? You shouldn't be doing this. But then I realize they don't have to, because everything is plug out, plug in, and software, but you still have connections that happen. And they do that at the workshop. They don't do it out on the road. And it's not. And so I talked to roadies today. It's a lot different than it was.
Mm-hmm. You know, I'm sure it is. You have a nonprofit.
Yes.
Tell us about the nonprofit.
Institute of Media Engineers, IME.
Right.
Call us at 404-200-5955. 404-200-5955. Institute of Media Engineers is, and talk to Leah Shagan. Institute of Media Engineers is a not-for-profit charity that benefits women and minorities in digital media, music and film, both. And I lean more towards film because I have a background in music. Mm-hmm. So my throwing my head and my life and my focus into film is where I'm at right now. And we bridge the gap in making it a reality and, you know, giving people who wouldn't normally get the experience to actually bring about their ideas for film, television, you know, music, and to know how to operate the equipment and to bring about a content, you know, bring about a production and make it happen. You know what it takes. You do a radio show. There's a lot that goes on.
These days, stuff on the side, hoping that doesn't distract you.
Exactly. I see you doing it, and you're doing it because you have something they didn't have 25, 20 years ago. The computers now. A phone has enough computer power now.
Yeah.
Okay? And let me just say, there is no reason, if you have an inkling to be involved in this industry, to not get in it and really get professional results.
Right.
Because the software, the computers, the plug and play, the technology, the internet, and people like me and IME, you know, to help you and guide you. And
Like the age group, is there a specific age group or is it just?
We started out with youth in Hilton Head. Rodney Jakes and I took this thing from just me out of our own pockets, helping kids rebuild computers and put the software on it and get in the studio to give them incentive to graduate high school. That's how it started.
Okay.
And I brought it to Atlanta and dealing with, I met Cynthia Collins and Eric Canada and Hakeem and Robinson and Regina Nicole. And the SCAD people, David Howell, and guys like that and people like that. And it just became this network of all these people who had these great ideas, great talent and technical expertise and experience in doing these things and reaching out to people who didn't but who wanted to, or even just they were on their way to graduating film school or music school or whatever the case was, and making it a reality for them, you know, making it something that was obtainable and reachable and doable. It's been moving along. We're positioning ourselves now to take charity and to take in-kind services, equipment, donations, money, and that's where Leia comes in. I'm not a businessman. I'm a creative director. And between her and Rodney Jakes, who's back in Hilton Head, South Carolina, between the two of them, we are now moving for 2015 to take us national.
Oh, that's great.
Yes.
I'm glad to hear that. That's great. Yes.
That's what we're focusing on that. I got my first feature film that I'm co-executive producing. And of course I'm doing the music and a couple other things. But I'm not trying to get multiple paydays here. All it is this is part of what happens when you're an independent and you know how to do these things. It's better that you know how to do all these things.
Exactly.
You produce a radio show, like I said, you're doing everything.
Yes.
That a station would have several people doing.
Exactly.
But because you have the computer and the software and you have the know-how and the experience
mm-hmm.
and the confidence in yourself,
mm-hmm.
which is really the most important thing.
Yes.
Okay?
Gotta have it.
You gotta have it, you know. My dad grew up in an era where they had the deck stacked against them in mm-hmm. so many areas,
mm-hmm.
you know. Of course, you know, racial.
Yes.
And then education and economic. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, and great men. These guys, two great men came out of that era. So some of that rubbed off. I think some of it, the good stuff rubbed off
mm-hmm.
to give me the work ethic to never give up my dream and always be investing in what it is I'm doing and sharing it, more importantly, with
mm-hmm.
others who aren't sure or don't have the confidence level to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where IME, Institute of Media Engineers, has its backbone. That's the core of its mission statement.
I am glad to hear that. Real quick, before we head out, mm-hmm. Your band.
The Hard Donuts.
And what you got going on the website? Real quick.
Rock and Roll Blues Gorillas, just having a good time. Scott Negron, Dave Masaryk, Ryan on guitar, Scott on drums.
Come on.
Scott Negron on drums. We play in Woodstock. We're mm-hmm. at Little Whisper Lounge at 6889 Highway 92. We do an open mic night every Thursday. Come down and sing, play the drums, play guitar. Come on stage, do your song, do your thing, and we will back you up.
Mm.
Okay? No fees. Come in and just sign and have a great time. It's great food. And tomorrow night is Thursday night,
yeah.
So you will see us there. And we are in our fifth week of taping our own reality series.
That's hot.
Yeah, and we are hoping to shout.
That's hot.
We're like the Monkees, if you remember the Monkees or the Beatles, meets Duck Dynasty meets American Idol.
Uh-huh.
So the American Idol part is people who want to get up on stage and get their 15 seconds.
Right.
All right. It's no longer 15 minutes, kids. It's 15 seconds. Because there's too many people. But we also have a Thanksgiving talent expose. It's an opportunity for artists to perform on stage live, have guests see their talent, and be selected to participate in future Hard Donuts reality series tapings. So come on down on that. That's happening on the 20th. But come on down Thursday night and have a good time. We're in Woodstock.
And what time?
It's easy. We start at 8.
Mm-hmm.
So roughly 8 to 9, come in and sign up, get your food, get your drinks and whatnot. Talk to me about what you want to play. Talk to Scott. And the next thing we know is we can probably pull the star out of you. Who knows? We have all kinds of people that
come out.
Yeah, you're welcome.
So much. I appreciate
it. Little Whisper Lounge.
Little Whisper. Make sure you guys support. And as usual, we appreciate you tuning in and listening to the Bianca Burwell Show. We are here every day, Monday through Friday, 3 to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 2 p.m. Central. If you haven't done it already, like us on our Facebook page, The Beat Drops Radio, by going to TheBeatDropsRadio.com, clicking on the F, and that'll take you directly there. Once you do that, suggest us to all your friends. Follow us on Twitter, at Beat Drops Radio, and follow me on Instagram, Bianca_Burwell. We got Master Christian Dog Show. That comes on every Wednesday and Full Belly Radio as well. So keep it locked. We'll see you guys later. Appreciate it.
Bye.
Station with the best music.
How was that?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
I was losing it with the band. I lost the guy's names, but I got the important names.
Gino. It's like
Jay.
Gino. Yeah. I went to sleep at like 10 minutes to 1. And woke up at 6:10.
Oh,
yeah.